So today, of course, we're talking about the one thing that seems to elude even jazz musicians sometimes. You know, like I gotta put this mic up so you know. We're talking about the one thing today that seems to elude even jazz musicians, like swing. This is what is swing, right? It seems to be one of these things that everybody seems to simultaneously agree on what it is and also disagree on what it is. We all seem to have this idea of like what this thing is. And even me, listen, I got my ideas of what it is too, but that's why all I'm doing today is to show you based on history and evidence what swing is, what we have come to agree on it is, and what we, even though we may not be able to give you a clear definition of exactly what it is, we can tell you what it is not when we hear it, because swing is a feeling. It's simultaneously a genre of music and a feeling. So today, what we're doing is we're going to isolate the most common rhythmic feeling in jazz, swing, right? And we're going to help identify the most famous / common accents, because I'm talking about swing as an accent of jazz. Within swing, i.e. the different ways people swing and how they can easily be recognized by them. Now, why is swing important? The reason why swing is important, because if you remember from last week, and also if, you know, from last week's jazz school, and from the jazz school, I think maybe 2 or 3 jazz schools ago, we talked about the blues. We talked about how important the blues was and why the human element is what makes this music sound so different. Every one of these jazz schools is not just to be pessimistic about what's going on, but also just to give you an idea of what makes jazz so unique and why it's so hard during this quarantine period to actually play jazz for real in the way that we've learned how to play it, you know, because the one of the most difficult things about us as jazz musicians right now in this situation is that we're at odds for doing to try to do the thing that we essentially spent our entire lives trying to do, which is interact with humans. Like in this time period when music is coming out and it seems that all we can do is just do distance covers, because it's either unsafe or unadvised. Even if you don't have the virus, it's just unadvised, just to keep the curve spread down so we can get back to playing faster. It seems the only thing we can do is just, you know, distance covers. And it's so hard for us to do the things that we, you know, went to school for, that we went into jam sessions, we bust our behinds, grinded, whatever we did just to get to this point, and now we have to, now we're stuck in our houses, apartments, wherever. It's difficult, right? But there is a silver lining, and we can get to it. And all what this is, the good thing about all the time that we're not having right now is that now we have time to look within ourselves and to get better and to grow and isolate some of those elements that maybe we didn't have time to understand before. Maybe because we are, you know, these gigs or sessions and we felt so rushed to get to the thing. Well, now you don't have to rush, because even though the unfortunate thing is we don't know when we're going to gig again, the good thing is that we have a perpetually infinite amount of time to practice. So now we can take these things, and I have time to like work on my craft. I now have time to get these things out to you in the way that I want it to. So we're taking advantage of this time to make sure that everybody is caught up to speed. And so that specifically is why this class is not just for jazz musicians, but now we get a chance to connect in another way with people that are not jazz musicians, like those of y'all who are just fans like me. Listen, I told you all plenty of times, I didn't start off playing this thing. I started off playing this thing. this is not specifically the switch, but you know, this is the instrument that I started on. So of course I feel like I owe my life to the community that helped me to be here. And so the community to be here, of course, is the video game and anime and J-pop community. Later on that I found out to be J-pop. So a lot along the way, we're going to try to use a lot of different analogies to to help you guys understand the things that I've come to learn with this thing, that instrument, you know, being the saxophone and the language known as jazz. So we try to do some analogies along the way. This class that we're going to be doing today has a little less jazz analogies, but that's because you don't really need them. If I find one that I feel like is necessary, then I'll put it in. But I just wanted to get to the meat and potatoes of the thing, because this is something that anybody at any level can understand, whether you're just beginning and don't even know what the word jazz even means, you don't know what the heck it is, or if you're already playing with Herbie Hancock, you know, out there, you know, you're all the way out there in the world and you just still need to refresh yourself on the history. I got to refresh myself on the history all the time, constantly, because it's really important. Like when I was writing this script, I realized like, man, I got a lot of these details and I got a lot of these bullet points in my head, but there's still some details that, because I don't live with them every day, I got to go back and study them again. So I went back and put together some notes and made kind of an abridged version of kind of like a history of swing, not even just a history, just like the major points that they are and how they exist. So, you know, just to go along with the script here, you know, everyone has different swing feels. And that means, actually, before I even go on that, let's just talk about like why this is important to understand. So the reason why this is important to understand is because there's a lot, like this was inspired by the fact that it's hard to swing in a distance cover way, like, you know, somebody sends the bass track and then you swing with this. You actually have to kind of try harder depending on what instrument you get first in the distance cover thing. The reason why is because a swing, just like all of jazz, is based on live interaction, being able to hear something. So as we talked about in the how to play like a team, like an esports team in jazz, the bass and the drum hookup is extremely important. Remember that back line with the slayer? The back line and the slayer have to be on point. The back line needs to make sure he has a good clear feel of view of the map. And the slayer needs to have a good feel of the map in front of him, so they're both there to back each other up. So the ride cymbal and the bass are there to back each other up constantly. So how do you account for all those little inconsistencies and those little tendencies that happen to be natural and dynamic when you can't be there live to kind of adjust with them, right? So it gets a little harder, but it's still possible. I've seen people do it. There's a lot of different, you know, there's a lot of different covers that are coming out that I'm actually seeing, which is really cool. Sapphire, backline needs to just be a beacon for me to jump to. Wow, see, that kind of thinking is exactly what kind of thinking is exactly what'll get you your bass player to either fire you or not want to play with you. You can't just rely on the bass player. You guys both have to make your job easier. If the backline is there for you to jump to, he needs to understand that you can also protect him. Anyway, I know you were joking, but still. Okay, anyway, now we can move on. Just to let you know why I'm talking about this. So everyone has different time feels of swing, right? Meaning the way you feel the rhythm of swing. And you can think of swing like accents, you know? So if someone is from the American South, like me, they will most likely have a Southern accent, even though mine kind of went away a little bit. If someone is from France, they'll most likely have a French accent, you know? Or somebody like Vince, if he's from Italy, he probably has an Italian accent. Or Bob, I think he's from Spain, I remember. So he has a Spanish accent. So on and so forth, whatever. So, however, within these places, you can also have, like, regional differences in dialects. Someone from North Carolina will have a different accent than someone from, say, Texas, right? So even though they're both from the South, and even then, two people from within the same state, city, or even town can both have completely different accents. However, there is an unmentioned glue that connects the North Carolinian to the Texan because of an identifiable, at least, and familiar umbrella accent, right, that they can hear and come to because of the similar upbringing they all seem to have, even if they were to meet somewhere in the North where no one speaks like them. So this is precisely what we're going to be talking about today. How and why swing is important for playing jazz. If jazz is a language, swing is the accent. And so when two or more people can come together with regional differences but still swing on the same level, magic happens. That's what we're talking about. Magic happens. You know, the music is given life due to this mutual conversation. That being said, of course, swinging is one of the many things in jazz that you can't do properly without humans, regardless if it's like one person or two people. You don't need a full band or live interaction to do it, of course, but the feeling of it is greatly enhanced when multiple people can swing together. Think like think power stacking. You know, think stacking, right? You know, like you can put one, if you play Splatoon or something, you can put one main power up on. But if you put two main power, okay, it gets even better. Okay, it just keeps getting better, right? And you can never have too much of that because it only just gets better, right? So swing can single-handedly be the difference between something sounding really corny and sounding amazing. Now, jazz, you already know what I'm talking about, right? There's almost no gray area in between. You know, this can be up to interpretation. For example, if someone is purposely going for a cheesy or corny sound, but this is usually not on purpose, right? Most of the time, here's the thing. I got some situations. When you hear a corny swing sound, it's usually because A, they don't know any better, or B, they don't care to know any better. Because I make this argument. The reason I make this argument about swing, because once you actually know how to swing, or even just know what real swing is, right, and can listen for it, it's such an infectious thing. It's an infectious feeling that you just don't want to do anything else. You really don't. It's true. Ask anybody who like has that feeling. You know, I'm not saying you don't want to play straight music. No, I'm saying if you are swinging and you're in a situation of playing swing, you do not want to play any corny thing once you know what the real thing is. And it takes time, you know. But anyway, so what I'm going to do today is give a little history and some examples of the most famous / common styles of swing that became common because of the impact they had on generations of musicians, listeners, and dancers alike. Keep that in mind, dancers. So that being said, anybody like put up the hand emoji. We're gonna act like this is class for real. Raise your hand if you think you know what swing is. Don't explain it. Don't type it. Just raise your hand if you think you know what swing is, and I'm gonna call on one of you. If you think you can write it down in a short sentence in words what swing is, I'm really curious. If you can, it's okay. Just raise your hand. Give me a hand emoji. If not, that's cool, because I can move on. But if, you know, I'll give it like, you know, I'll give it maybe 15, 20 seconds. Okay, Vince, go ahead. Vince, what do you think swing is? Give me a definition of swing, Vince. No worries. This is not to call anybody out. I'm not calling any. I just want to know like what your thoughts about swing are and see if it, you know, how have you come to identify it in your life? You can tell, but you can't explain. That's okay. That's okay. So I saw Vince raise his hand first. So why don't you go ahead and I'm just waiting on if you can, you know, explain something. If not, we're going to move it along just to keep the stuff moving, you know. And Wumi, I'm not even sure if that's like a full idea, but you said it's when you move your eighth notes like that, that we're actually going to talk about that like really soon too. So. Ooh, thanks for the host. Appreciate you. It's weird. The way I heard it was a feeling based on the triplet. We're going to get to that too. Don't worry. We are going to get to that. People have been trying to explain what swing is for the entire century. And all people can do is give anecdotes. So what we have as an opportunity right now is to go back and look at history and to see exactly what were people doing and how to actually figure that out. But Vince, see, to me, swing is your personal control of the pulse in the music. There's personal and communal. That's a cool answer. That's a cool answer. That is related to what we're talking about, right? That is definitely, but it's not really talking about the music itself, but that's a good answer. So great. I'm glad you gave it to it. I'm going to move on right now because you all actually gave really good answers. That tells me that you have been thinking about it in a way, which is great. That's what we want. We want people to keep thinking about what this is and what this means. You all are definitely on the right track and you're definitely not wrong with what you're thinking. But there are, everything you guys are saying are a part of the puzzle that we're talking about and things that I've thought about too. So I would say that if most of you were to identify it, you'd probably talk about the distance between two notes, right? If we had some kind of a definition, if we could put it, it's like the distance between two notes, that's how you would define it. Well, what if I told you it was more than that, right? What if I told you it was more than that? Sometimes it has absolutely nothing to do with the notes themselves. And Vince kind of touched on that, which is cool. But if swinging was simply a matter of me putting a little more space in between two notes, I could easily take one song that was played by real people, put it into a DAW or something, and it would feel the same, right? Right? Of course, it wouldn't sound the same because of the instruments are MIDI, but it should feel the same, right? Let's see. So I actually spent 5 minutes making this little thing. I want to see if I can go find it again. I had it. So I spent 5 minutes making this little MIDI file in Finale. I was going to put up the Finale file, but it caused a little problems when I was testing out the stream earlier. So I'm going to just, I put in Billy's Bounce into Finale. I gave it a little bass line and I gave it a little drum set. Just one chorus. I gave it just one chorus. Just because like we want to test that theory. If swing is just triplets, right? Swing is just the triplet. All you need is to know is just a triplet. Right? That's all you know. It's a theory, right? If all you need is the distance between the notes, even with Finale playback, right? It should feel good. If you just know that if it's just triplets, right? We're going to crash that argument right now. Tell me if you like, even if you like this, cool. Everybody got different tastes, but I can tell you that like 99% of people who would listen to this, and are jazz fans would be like, yeah, it's Finale, of course. We always used to make fun of that a lot. So, but anyway, let's go check this out. This is the Billy's Bounce version. I'm gonna go to this just for right now, because we're gonna be, actually, you know what? Let's go back here because I don't have the video for it. But here is Billy's Bounce on Finale. Okay. All right. Okay. Right? Ba-da, ba-da, ba-da. You get triplets in there. No. I'm telling you, if anybody, we're going to get to that, right? It's like, yeah, it's just, if you put it in a video game, it's like, hey, they tried to swing. Cool. You know, not feeling it, right? Not feeling it. You'd rather hear it straight. It would groove more. Why? That's what we're trying to figure out. Why would you rather hear that straight than swung? That's because it's so much harder to swing than it is to play straight. And we're going to go over some of those elements today. Why? Well, now, let me show you the original recording of Billy's Bounce. The original recording of Billy's Bounce by Charlie Parker. And this is a groover. This is one we've been, nobody, every Grammy band audition that ever was, for some reason, they always play it like too fast. They always like to play it like trying to be like more modern, because they know that if they try to play it, it's harder to play it at the slow tempo. Because it's hard to dig into the groove. But check out the way Bird and them do it. It's beautiful. Great tune. Same tune. Woo. Hey, thanks for the raid, yo. Thank you so much. Hey, ha, hey. Woo. Come on now, come in and swing with us. Come in and swing with us, Dom. Ha. Okay, now of course I'd want to play that entire recording, but that would take up the whole, you know, it's killing. It's beautiful. It's great. You can't control my body while listening to this. Help. Yeah, right? You can't, you can easily control your body when listening to this. Right? Why? I even put human playback on. Why? Well, that's what we're going to explain today. And hopefully by the end of this, you'll at least have an introduction as to why that do not feel good and why we do not talk about that. Thank you, Don, for the raid. That's awesome, man. Appreciate you coming up in here. We are learning about swing. This is very, very difficult to explain, but we're going to be going to some examples. Okay, so, you know, there's something missing from it, right? That's the whole point, right? There's one of the most important things missing. The first element is inconsistency. Wow. Inconsistency, right? So if you look in Finale settings for playback, I wish I could show up. I wish I could pull it up right now. If you look in Finale settings for playback, wow, 105 viewers. That's crazy. That's awesome. There will be an option for enable human playback. So what this means is that Finale will generate a series of random errors. I'm serious. It'll generate a series of random errors in between notes values and velocities to make it appear as if it is human. Since we, as humans, can never do something exactly the same every single time. We're not robots. We're not robots, okay? Now, the entire history of swing is complicated, right? And various sources can be identified as to where exactly it came from, but in the interest of time, since that can take about 3 or 4 hours of itself easily, we're going to only focus on the major points in the time that influence the way we think about swing today. And that's where we are going to commence the history. Oh, wait, John, do you remember? John Hadamiya, for some reason, I just did that sound subconsciously. Let's go into the mind of a Greg Jennings. Put the team on my back, dude. It's taking it way back. I hope you're still in here and you remember that. But anyway, moving on. Step one. All right, let's focus. Step one, to understand swing, you must understand that it did not start off the way we talk about it today. Swing was a style of music, okay? Swing was a style of music separate from what people call jazz. Seriously. And you couldn't separate it from the most popular form of social gathering, dancing. Everybody wanted to dance. The music was the dance, and the dance was the music. So swing, of course, was actually a genre. It's completely separate. So the rhythm of swing was being developed organically before the advent of the swing era, of course, but people weren't calling this new craze swing until the mid-1930s, when bands led by band leaders such as Benny Goodman, Fletcher Henderson, Andy Kirk and his Clowns of Joy, Count Basie, Duke Ellington, whole bunch of them started performing at various hotspots, touting the name swing in song and event titles, okay? One of the earliest songs to carry the word swing in its title was actually the 1932 classic that was originally called Moton Stomp, and it's called Moton Swing from 1932 by the early Kansas City swing pioneer Benny Moton. He's super important. He was a man who would soon serve as the mentor for one of the greatest band leaders of all time, none other than Count Basie. None other than Count Basie. So Moton and his band, featuring the now legendary rhythm section members of Count Basie on piano. Remember, Moton also played piano too. Benny Moton played piano, right? And Walter Page on the bass. And they established something completely different that the world had never heard before in popular music. Four on the floor. That's right. Doom, 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 doom. What we know as four on the floor started all the way back then. From New Orleans to Kansas City, going all the way up through. This is the original four on the floor, okay? This is where it all started. Maybe not the same way you're used to hearing it, but the concept of all four beats being played at once with different syncopations accented on different instruments had never been done like this before. They were doing it in New Orleans, right? With different types of stomp, but they weren't doing it like the way this was happening. Because now, the drums are no longer the only carrying member of the rhythm, but the bass and guitar were just as important. Okay, tuba was no longer the main bass instrument here. So you got to remember that in New Orleans music, they were playing sousaphone. And the tuba has a long boom, boom, boom. You can play short notes, boom, boom, boom. But it's going to be too, right? No matter how hard you plug the bass, it's doom, doom. You can hear the rhythm first. So bass is getting a lot more popular during this time. So that means that the punchy rhythmic sound of the acoustic upright bass will follow for a deeper yet more subtle rhythms to be played. You also got to remember, there were no amps yet. So they were playing gut strings that were easier to play. That wasn't as hard to play as the metal strings. And you also had more of a thump against the wood. So that's what happened. All right? And so the felt not heard sentiment would also be born in this configuration. Meaning that you want the rhythm section to be the most important no matter what. Rhythm, rhythm. So let's go listen to a little bit of Moton Swing by Benny Moton and the Kansas City Orchestra. It's a really great song. Y'all should check this out. Matter of fact, before I even say this, I want y'all to pay very close attention to the way the bass is moving and the way the different horn figures come in. I'm not gonna play the whole thing. It's unfortunately, but you can hear what's going on. Just take a listen. Got us the drums, snare drum. Snare drum. Swing. Woo! Saxes. Boogie woogie. Uh-huh. Okay, I'm going to skip a little bit ahead so you can hear a bit of the full band playing and how they kick it off. Hear the main melody, the main motif here. Notice how you can't sing the triplet in that. Like you can try, but it's not what the rhythm is. Check out this ending. They popping it right here. Soul killing, beautiful. Okay, moving right along right now. Okay, so this music was so popular across the United States at the time, people couldn't get enough of it, right? When they heard it. Other songs like Kansas City Shuffle, of course, were also hits of the Moton Band. And of course, all of the band leaders in New York took notice of the sound. You got to keep in mind, like Benny Goodman, Fletcher Henderson, all of them, they heard this sound. Now, I don't mean to skip a lot of history here, but it's important to mention that Count Basie would also leave soon after to make his own band, which got even more notoriety, arguably, than Benny Moton could have ever asked for. Taking from the conventions he learned from Moton, however, he kept the big 11-piece horn configuration, this time augmenting the band with that legendary rhythm section I mentioned before. Count Basie on piano, Walter Page on bass, Freddie Green on guitar, and one of the fathers of all big band drumming, Papa Joe Jones. Drummers, y'all know what I'm talking about. Everybody who to this day is still considered one of the greatest drummers of all time. Freddie Green even played, he played quarter notes. Freddie Green played quarter notes only in his band for 50 years and never took one solo, ever. On guitar, he kept that rhythm section going no matter what. He's an inspiration, and it's also could be a lesson. So y'all who just like want to play all this, you know, we got different inspirations, but this is another guy you can learn from. So this band rarely played with sheet music and made riffs on the spot to all of their tunes. And once swing music was getting popular, of course, you know, people had to get down to it. The dances that follow were either continuations of already known dances or new crazy moves altogether. One particular crazy dance movement was the Lindy Hop. Now, part of the whole jitterbug craze. If you knew how to Lindy Hop, you were the talk of the town. I like to use that. You know, you were the talk of the town. And the bands that played this music needed to be tight and right. If you weren't swinging, the dancers would let you know in one way or another. You know, that means your music needed to incite the movements of dancers. So let's go ahead and check out an example of some Lindy Hopping. Now, this is from the film Hell's a Poppin' by Whitey's Lindy Hoppers. And this video is now an immortal dance classic. And this is a lot faster, of course. It's a lot faster than what we would normally consider to be swing music. But just to understand the different varieties and boundaries and limits of swing music, right? The different varieties you can hear. This is Lindy Hopping. So this is the kind of dancing that if you went to a swing club, you might see this when the music got really hot, as they say. Check this out.
Hey, Pops, keep that beat a beat. I feel a rhythmic brainstorm coming on. One, two, keep that rhythm heating. One more rhythm like that, and I'll be gone.
Uh-huh.
Oh, man, don't stop now. We're jumping. Give everything the Lord now. This thing might turn into something.
Come on.
I'm mistaken. Here comes something now.
Burn it. But it's jump music. Jump music. Uh-huh. Oh, yeah. Come on. Come on. Get down. Come on. I love this video. Woo! Oh, nice. Nice, Jazz. I'm glad y'all sharing it on this week. Good. It's important. Tell me about it, bro. Come on, man. Hey. Oh. Uh-huh. Oh, kick his butt, kick his butt. Oh, come on. Lamel, you know that the page that it comes from is like right here, right? Come on! Ah. Hey! That's what I'm talking about right here. Yeah, take a rest, take a rest. You know what I'm saying? Okay. Right? That's important. So, that was happening, you know. Swing was and is dance music. But of course, this music was so popular that everyone wanted to play this way. It got to the point that this became the popular way of speaking, so to speak. Just like how hip-hop nowadays got so popular that everyone wanted to speak like rappers or speak hood, even if you weren't playing hip-hop music or listening to it at all. Words like, for example, for show, I, dog, bruh, what up, word, facts, etc. They got etched into our vocabulary in the modern day, right? It could be, you could be a normal kid from the middle of nowhere in Wisconsin, and you're still saying facts and word just because that's what the cool kids in your school are doing. That's just what the cool kids are doing, right? So this is the same thing that happened to what we know as jazz music. And jazz musicians at the time played in these swing bands to make money, gain fame, and to be with the in crowd at the time. Naturally, during and after these times, the vernacular that the musicians would learn would carry over and morph into their own personalities. You know, I would love to talk more about the history of swing, but we got to get to some examples. this is a general, you know, so now for the purpose of these examples is just to show you all the many different ways you can swing, and how some of the most influential musicians in history have had their swing copied by generations of musicians ever since. Of course, the other reason is to show you why you can't just tell a computer to offset some notes by 45% in Logic and call it swing. You can't just do that, right? So let's get to some examples. Now, of course, in these examples, I'll be using a couple of different arbitrary labels. I say arbitrary because, you know, these are just conjecture, right? It's either stuff that I've heard that we all say in the community or things that I've made up. Just some things that I've made up just to help you have a... So when you listen to this music, you can have some things that bounce into the back of your head that you could say to somebody and they would know exactly what you mean, right? You could say, oh, this is this type of swing. This is this type of swing. They'd be like, oh, okay, cool. So if you can go back and listen to these examples, if you can see some of these examples, you'll be able to understand and hopefully go back and memorize them. So the first one we're going to talk about is New Orleans swing, right? So let's start from the beginning. Earlier, I told you all about how swing wasn't really called swing until the 1930s. But obviously, this doesn't mean it just came out of nowhere, right? It didn't come out of a vacuum. In fact, there are many roots of swing, and some of the ways of playing rhythm have been posthumously, after the fact, called swing to fit the whole lexicon of the jazz language. So I don't necessarily argue that... I don't necessarily agree that some of these rhythms can arguably be called swing, but they're still important nonetheless, right? That's why I was talking a little bit about how the triplet is not exactly the thing yet. We'll get to that. We're going to talk about it. So one of the fathers of our music, and of course the man single-handedly responsible for our ability to play jazz today, Louis Armstrong, is credited with not only teaching the world how to sing, but also how to swing, right? I think some of this is conjecture a little bit, but let's look at it anyway. New Orleans is the birthplace of our first examples of fusion music in America, and jazz was born here as a result. I've played some Louis Armstrong on this channel before, right? Maybe I'll, you know, some of the stuff that I've done for the blues or whatever. But for the sake of this lesson, let's look at what we call New Orleans swing. This is a type of swing feel that can be characterized by its Caribbean roots. Do I mean Louis? No, I mean Louis. Mostly because the musicians that primarily created and performed this music were Creole or had some Caribbean ancestry. So by this time, music was still very homogenous. And you can really hear those clear roots in the way the musicians are playing. The instruments that are most responsible for creating the backbone of this sound are like the snare. You listen for the snare drum, the banjo, and the horn instruments playing in a more articulated rhythmic sense. So meaning like ghosted notes, the way, you know, like ghosted, like, you know, like that kind of thing, that wasn't happening. They were not a thing yet. And this style of music is common for all the instruments to be playing counterpoint to each other during solos. You'll notice here that the notes aren't swung that hard yet. It's very much quarter note driven, and it will become the backbone for all swing music to come after it. So instead of like, if I were to play good example is you can play the Athletic theme. Or no, here we go. Let's play the theme to Overworld from Mario, Super Mario Brothers 2, right? Let's play the theme from that in two different ways. Here's the bebop way to play the intro. But if you were to play it more of like the traditional jazz style, you play... Or even better yet, it's It's a little more accented, and it's every instead of like ghost notes, it's straight down the middle. It's a little hard to play with that melody, I realize. That's not the way I would do it, but that was the first thing that came to my head. Anyway, let's listen to this. The King Oliver Band featuring a young Louis Armstrong in 1923 playing a song based on his own nickname, Dipper Mouth Blues. Let us check it out. Now, the fidelity, of course, you're going to have to forgive me. This is 1923, so that's almost 100 years old, so you got the, you know, but this is what we're used to listening to, so there's a charm behind it. Check it out, and it's short, so we'll play the whole thing. There he is, King Oliver, on the picture, not playing. King Oliver played cornet. Come on. I love when they do that. I love that. You know when they get that? Yeah, rhythm there. Play that thing.
Oh, play that thing.
Hey. Hey. Double ending is what we call it. Double ending is when you tag the one, when you just play a couple of extra bars after where you would normally end. So for 12 bar blues, play extra 2 bars at the end of it instead of ending right on the 12 bar. So I sounded a little longer. Developed in New Orleans. Okay, great. So that was Dipping My Blues. Now, actually, at the end of this, remind me, I want to play a very important video to cap off. It's called Where the Blues Is Born. I think I have it in here. Hopefully, if y'all stick around to the end, it's a great Louis Armstrong video. I was going to play it right now, but I want to move ahead so that we're, you know, moving right along with the criteria in the curriculum. But it's a really, really cool video where, like, Louis was actually subject to, like, this dude, like, 12 years ago put a hip-hop beat underneath it. I don't know why he did that, but it's the absolute perfect video to show the connection between jazz and hip-hop because Louis is, like, rapping. He's rapping in 1947. He's going off. Like, he's just going off in the music, and it sounds so good. I got to play it for you at the end of this. But anyway, going back to where we were, let's talk about the swing form that probably most people would know the most. This is called classic swing. We're calling this classic swing or easy swing, right? This swing feel is what we know as a standard swing feel or easy swinging. Without downplaying its importance, of course. We don't want to say easy swinging to say that it's not difficult, but this is where the standard swing ride cymbal pattern comes from. Ding, 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 ding. This is what we're talking about. This is the classic swing sound. And we call this standard because it's usually the first sound people think of when they think of swing music. We're highlighting the Count Basie Orchestra here once again. We did Benny Moten, but now we're talking about Count Basie's actual orchestra, so you get to hear that. For those of you who are not familiar with them, because they're probably the best band to play this feel, like uncontested to this day. And every high school, college, and professional band tries to get to this level of swinging, if they're hip, of course. By the time of this, I actually personally grew up on that too. Like, you know, shout outs to Mr. Dorsey. You're incredible, Christopher Dorsey. That's it. All he talked about. Count Basie. Get with Count Basie. Just got to get it. No matter what, you always got to go back to Count Basie. So by the time of this period, the Count Basie Orchestra, the conventions of swing rhythm had been set, pretty much, with the innovations and developments to follow later on, of course. Now it's called, we call it easy swinging, not because it's easy to play, but because it feels easy to listen to, right? It makes you sway and pat your foot. You snap your fingers, you know? It just feels nice. And you're talking about, we'll get to that. So the main characteristics of classic swing, which carry over into the other styles of swing, include playing all four beats on the ride cymbal, an innovation that drummers like Kenny Clarke and Papa Joe Jones brought to the table, which loosens up the sound palette of the band so that the harshness of the snare drum isn't so constantly happening. So instead of like, cat, very specific sound, you get a little more nuance with the ting, ting, ting. There's a lot more, you're not playing as many low frequencies, you're in the high frequencies, the way the low frequencies of the other instruments can pass through it, right? It's not like they were thinking about frequencies, but they found out when playing like that, it opened up a whole new way of grooving and listening. So, and also playing the hi-hat with your foot and with your foot on 2 and 4, which lets people know right away what beats you're supposed to clap on. Hint, hint. This is why we snap on 2 and 4. So if you hear ting, 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 you know what I'm saying? Like, you lean into the second beat. So if it's 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, cut, and then all the upbeats you do can cut. That's what makes it feel good, is that gravity, up and down. Clave is the same thing. We can do a masterclass on Latin music at some point later too, and how important clave is. But clapping on 2 and 4 is super important. That's why you go 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2. You always snap. Easy. Easy. Just like that. Okay? And the bass is playing all four beats in a walking style. And pardon me for my haphazard definition of walking for all the bass players, but pretty much this means instead of playing triads or roots the whole time, like what was common, the bass is playing long form melodic bass lines, right? For those who are not familiar with the sound of walking bass, you may have heard that they outline the chords as opposed to playing each individual note in them. So playing smaller intervals that flow like a melody help to give the feeling of perpetual motion in the song, just like it doesn't want to end until it stops. This is the reason why swing feels so different from typical pop music. So you can just straight up walk the scale. You can walk up the scale. Like, you can just walk up the scale and it feels different than. It's totally different. But when you're playing those, when you play that, it gives this feeling of motion. And then when you snap on 2 and 4, it's just in there. Easy. Right? So the song we're gonna listen to now is a classic that every swing band musician knows and remains one of the most famous staples from the Count Basie repertoire, Shiny Stockings. Beautiful song. It's written by the amazing Frank Foster. Let's take a listen. We're gonna play up the sweet solo. Here's Sweet Edison solo, just so you can hear it, you know. See if you snap on 2 and 4 here. If you can't snap, clap. Easy. Right? Try clapping. One, two, three, four. 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 Right? Two, four. Let's dig into that. Woo! What? You think of that the episode of Family Guy, Quagmire? Like, if you watch Family, and he's like, there's like big band music playing. Cause you know Seth MacFarlane's a big band fanatic. He's playing big band music, and he's like, there's like a, I forgot, there's like Meg comes in, or some girl comes in, and he's like turning all the lights on in the house and all kind of stuff, hitting the hits with his wine glass, all kind of stuff. That's the feeling, just easy. Relaxing. Okay, saxes come in. Here we go. Right? Now the ride cymbal's coming in. Now watch what happens when the solo comes in. swinging too. Hear that guitar? All four beats, easy swinging. Just feels nice. Right? The amount of times I've had to play this, it's my favorite. I'll never get tired of it. Shout! Easy. Just ride out. Easy. Ho! Oh, you gotta hear the soli. John, yes, that's what our old college band director used to say. I'm not gonna say the whole stream. Oh, back down. Touch. Swinging. Woo! Okay, see, I can't play the whole thing just because it's like there's like two more minutes of it and it's gonna cut into it. And once you listen to the next part, like a bagel rolling up the you wildin', bro. But yo, you know what I'm saying? Like if I play the whole rest of it, if I play just the next second after it, you're going to want to listen to the whole thing. So just go check it out on your own. You see the recording up there. Just look up Count Basie, Shining Stockings. Make sure it's the original one. You can check out this logo on the screen if you want to make sure that you're getting the right one. But you can't go wrong with any version. But this is like the classic staple version. Okay. That's Sean Jones says, yeah. Everybody got their own ways, you know, mnemonic devices, right? So now, you notice the difference between the New Orleans, which is like more active, you know, like it's all in there, right? You can identify that. And then you have the classic swing. And still, what comes next? Well, this next one is a little tricky to differentiate from what we call as classic swing because they were actually being developed at the same time. But we're going to be talking about bebop swing. Bebop swing, right? Bebop swing is different from easy swing, however, because of the rhythmic interactive freedom that the rhythm section has, as opposed to classic swing, right? There's a lot more rules when you're playing classic swing to make that thing feel tight as a unit because you're driving 15 people or more in a band. So you got to make sure that certain things have to be powerful and done together. That's what it is. But in a bebop form, it's a little more free form. So the reason for this is because unlike classic swing, the beboppers were not playing for dancers. This is a new thing. For those of you who came to my why is jazz not popular anymore jazz school from about 2 or 3 weeks ago, you know, I talked about how bebop was jazz was split into two directions because of World War II. You talked about how World War II kind of split the music into two kind of different directions. And this is one of the things that happened. Now we can take a little closer look. Y'all gonna meme me for that forever now. But anyway, just to bring back the focus in, most of these musicians, even though, like, you know, they were doing new things, they came from swing dance bands and they carried over their experience from there to form a base for which they would experiment from. Now, in bebop swing, the drums are more active, where the snare drum is the most active voice. And the piano was comping a lot more in the cracks with the chords as opposed to just little riffs like you heard Count Basie doing. The bass is still walking all four notes. But, so if you're, I love it. Oh boy, taking a closer look. No, that'll be Adam Neely's jazz school. Anyway, the bass is still walking all four notes, but this time the roots might be out of the question, right? So instead of just playing one all the time, you know, sometimes a lot more inversions will be played. The bass drum is also free from playing on all four beats, which was common in early swing music and New Orleans music, and can now be used as an extra instrument for interactions. You can comp with the snare drum and the bass drum. The tempos are also a lot faster than in swing music, And because of the all the interaction going on, it's harder for the dancers to understand what's going on in a traditional sense. You can still bop your head to it, but jitterbugging didn't really fit for the people who wanted to dance. Live bebop was a lot more free than in the studio. So for this example that we're going to look at, one of the greatest jam sessions, bro. One of the greatest jam sessions to ever be recorded. Miles Davis' show on Birdland 1951. Specifically the song Half Nelson, which is a contrafact, which is a new melody written over another song's chord changes. So the contrafact is to Lady Bird, which is a standard by Tad Dameron. Now pay very close attention to the drummer on this track and how he interacts with the band, who would later also become one of the greatest drummers and band leaders in history. For those of y'all who know, you already know who I'm talking about, Art Blakey, right? This is before, and Art Blakey is like, he's like one of the biggest people, one of the biggest in the, wait, Professor, may I use the right? It's not like I can stop you. Anyway, yeah, so Art Blakey is like extremely popular in Japan, so it's actually great that we're referencing him, because like if you watch Kids on the Slope, you actually see Art Blakey's Monin featured in one of the episodes that they're buying it. And in one of the episodes they talk about John Coltrane just passed, like, oh my, it's crazy, what, John Coltrane died? And it's like it's so deep, it's a really 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 cool Art Blakey. That's right. Anyway, this is before he started his legendary band, the Jazz Messengers, and features him in a more freeform role than what people would later expect. Heavy hitters on this session, y'all. Like, this track specifically featured Miles on trumpet, J.J. Johnson on trombone, a young Sonny Rollins on tenor sax, and Kenny Drew on piano, and Tommy Potter on the bass, of course, as well as Art Blakey. So this one's actually like 7 minutes or so, so I'm only going to play a bit of this. You can hear just what is going on in this new style of swing. It's like a little more, you can hear elements from the old swing, so it doesn't sound too much different. But what makes it feel different is how, instead of just playing, again, not everybody's in the same unit, everybody's in a different place. So now they're playing more freeform roles. It's like playing Clam Blitz in Splatoon as opposed to playing Tower Control or Rainmaker. Everybody's moving together. No, everybody's kind of like, you got an objective. There's a clear objective in mind, but you're playing basketball now instead of football. You know what I'm saying? Basketball, you got your different positions. Everybody knows where the team is, but everybody has their specific roles that they're doing, and they're improvising in those roles. And that's why basketball can be so much compared to jazz. So anyway, let's check this recording out. It's one of the best recordings, like, ever. It's so killing. This is one of my favorite albums. Like, when I heard this, I was just like, yo, this is it. Our Blake is on fire, boy. On fire. People talk about Miles can't play high and fast. Listen to this, man. Shuffle him out. Okay. You loot it. Oh my God. Oh. It's my favorite. Let's not have Blakey back there. Shuffle them out. Oh my God. Bro. Oh. That was a moment. Yo, check out that moment. Miles said, he didn't play the top, so Art Blakey could come in. Again, you talked about Splatoon and roles. Like with Miles been doing this since back then. We talked about the roles of how to play in a team like you're on an esports team, right? So Miles faked them out. So if the audience is the team, right? If the audience is the other team, he faked them out by making them think, or even Smash too. Imagine jumping in Smash, right? And you're jumping to somebody that's shielding. They start shielding because they expect you to do an aerial. But instead, you jump and you land and you don't do nothing. And you grab them instead because you baited them to put their shield up. Same thing with playing Splatoon. You might have fired a shot over there or threw a bomb to make them think you're going over there. But you go to the other side because your other teammate shot ink for you. Because they knew that you were going to do – they saw you faking them out and you turn around and you got to slay them when they weren't looking. That's what just happened right here. Check this out. I'm going to kill you. Right here. Woo! Those little moments. That's a tomahawk note. Word. Anyway, you know, again, I could play that all day. I get so excited when listening to that. But anyway, check that out. You can check that recording out too. It's amazing. Anyway, let's move on. So now we get to we're at the crux of it. Triplet swing. Huh? Oh, okay. Now this is the one swing feel that ironically a lot of people don't think about when they talk about swing music. You'll know what I'm talking about this. Despite it having some of the most influence over musicians and educators alike. Despite what we know as the quarter note being the most important in a general sense for swinging, the triplet still has been an important part in establishing the important elements of swing music. However, this is mostly true for music. Get this. The reason why I don't talk about it in the way that you know about it is because this is mostly true for music after the 1940s. Mostly because of the drummer who changed the way many musicians would even hear swing or drumming, period, for the rest of the time. You know what it is? Elvin Jones. And why am I saying that it wasn't Papa Joe Jones or Kenny Clarke or any of those other guys before them that established triplet swing? That's because, ironically, it was Elvin Jones that made people aware of the power of the triplet. The power of it. People might have been thinking about it, but it was because of him and what he was taking the West African elements into his music that brought it to the new levels, right? That's the reason why it happened. When do we teach quintuplet swing? So good, right? Anyway, so you can argue that the triplet can be heard in a lot of different swing music, from Count Basie, Duke Ellington, whatever, to Lock In the Time Feel. But to be honest, again, Elvin Jones is the one musician who took that to the extreme. Taking elements from West African drum patterns and sounds, Elvin Jones brought the sound of the triplet to the entire drum set, creating a new type of flow that all musicians would then be enticed to play in. Horn players, piano players, bassists, everybody. Everybody wanted to get in with this new drum beat. This beat when Elvin played. And this is the new way of feeling swing became famous when he joined the John Coltrane Quartet. John Coltrane, right? In the 1960s. To this day, this style of swinging is still considered modern. And everyone knows, especially y'all out there, everyone knows when they hear it where it comes from. For those of y'all who don't know, they'll hear somebody in the session playing and go, oh, he's got that Elvin thing. He got that Elvin thing going on, you know? Countless drummers from across all genres have been influenced by him, but most notably, Mitch Mitchell, the drummer for the timeless Jimi Hendrix Experience, who says Elvin was his inspiration. I've been playing a lot of songs in 4/4, but here's a song by the John Coltrane Quartet in 3/4 called Spiritual from the Live at the Village Vanguard, right? It's a slow jazz swinger that almost feels like a church song more than a jazz waltz. Even though it's in 3/4. And I picked this one so you can really clearly hear the triplets that Elvin is playing across all the drums. Because in 3, you can hear the triplets and the slow, right? It's very, very, very clear. And how the entire band is playing in a triplet time, even though it is swinging while comping and soloing. The band is John Coltrane on tenor sax, Eric Dolphy on bass clarinet, McCoy Tyner on piano, Reggie Workman. Again, it was still us! Reggie Workman on bass, and Elvin Jones on the drums. So, I'm not going to play this whole thing, of course, because it's 12 minutes. The songs keep getting longer as the recording technology keeps getting better. But we're going to play this extremely important recording here, John Coltrane Spiritual. I'm going to skip a little bit through it just so you can get to the I'll play a little bit of like the top so you can get the how they establish this drone, right? They establish this drone, this feeling, soulful, spiritual thing, and then they break off into swing. So I'm gonna play a little bit of that so you can hear it. This is one of my favorite recordings of all time. Of the many recordings. Like there's four different recordings of this on four discs of the Vanguard set. This is amazing. We're gonna hear Eric Dolphy solo. No, we're not going to, unfortunately. I mean, you know me, I love Eric Dolphy, but we just wanna get through this, so. Reggie played the most swinging back. I can't remember Vince trolling. Check it out. Y'all listen to some wild stuff today. Thank y'all. Okay, I'm going to skip a little bit ahead. Check out Elvin. Now it's triplet. Now everybody's feeling the triplet. It's explicit. Hey, come on. Come on, man. This was the new way that people started to feel swing. They wanted to get to it.
No.
Right? Listen, listen, listen. You hear McCoy? Boom, boom, triplets. One, two, three, and get, three, and get. And then train. That's the zone. They're all in there. Accents. That's the triple. That's the triple. Come on. Woo. It draws a drone, you know, it's like bring it back to Africa, like, you know. Yeah. It makes you think, it makes you like, you know, look inside yourself, look at the world. Very introspective yet very personal and communal music. It's a music that both allows you to look within yourself and also look at other people. That's what the swinging is supposed to do. Huh? Okay, I can't play the whole thing because, of course, it's like, you know, it's just 12 minutes. You know, I mean, this one might be 13. This is 13 minutes. This is the third disc one. Okay, yeah. But, whew, the music almost feels alive. Yes, it 100% is. That's the whole point of me teaching all this kind of stuff. It's because of that. So, but anyway, we got one more example we're going to look at today. And what is this example? Well, it may throw you off a little bit. I am not talking about triplet. I'm not talking about New Orleans. I ain't talking about classic. No, this actually has nothing to do with that kind of thing. You know why? This is called straight swing. Straight swing? I like to, this is what everybody in the community calls it, like kind of a straight. They say swing was more straight. We say that, but I want to have a new word that I'm not sure people have used before. Fluid swing. Fluid swing. It's almost like non-binary swinging. You know what I mean? that's a way you can think about it. It's not conformed to any of the previous identities and the previous restrictions that the swing tradition has imposed on it. And sometimes swing can happen without even really swinging. In a traditional sense, of course. Let me say, hey, Pat, have you considered recording all these Sunday Jazz's original podcasts? They're actually up. Like I said, I plan after this, I'll finally be able to put them up. Because they're getting better. I'm finally able to, like, see how to flow with you guys. So, but anyway, the recording I'm going to play next actually isn't the first time you hear this in history, because you might have heard it in traditional stuff too, but they weren't really considering it swinging at that point, because they were still trying to play music like Frankie Trumbauer, Paul Whiteman. They weren't thinking about swinging. They were just taking the popular conceptions of the time, but also playing in the old march traditions that were still there. So they were still in the march style, and that's the reason why it sounded a little straighter. But this that I'm going to play for you is fluid, right? And what I mean by straight swing is that the notes that the musicians are playing aren't necessarily swung in the sense that we think about it, but they're still playing swing rhythms. In this case, the eighth notes are closer to sounding straight. And in the case that I'll be pointing out, they're closer to sounding like that because of the tempo and what the drummer is choosing to do. This is really important. We can look at this type of swing as also fluid swing because this has a different type of perpetual energy to it. Once you get to the 1960s, musicians are starting to take all sorts of liberties with swinging. With regards to the drums, people weren't so locked into the traditional 4/4 swing ding 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 pattern anymore. They can go ding ding digga ding digga digga ding digga ding 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 digga digga ding digga ding. They can play all sorts of time. They can play all sorts of time over this. Some of y'all, just by me singing that, any of y'all jazz musicians, y'all brains probably already lit up. You're like, oh, I know exactly who he's about to play. I know exactly, maybe not what we're recording, but I know what person he's gonna play. If you hear ding 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 ding, like it's just like it makes you go like, oh, like you kind of just sitting there like, woo, like it puts you in a different zone, different, totally different zone. Is there a warm march, Lee Konitz, eighth note more? Well, it's interesting because warm march, Lee Konitz still fit into the bebop swing that I'm talking about. Like for the purpose of me teaching this, you can definitely argue that they are kind of like that, but because they're playing more subdued rhythm, they're not playing as hard rhythm as the people that I'm talking about right now, I still put them in the bebop category because they're still calling from the bebop era of musicians. Even though they're obviously, they wouldn't call their music bebop, it's totally different, but that's definitely close to what I'm thinking of. But anyway, you know, the hi-hat didn't have to play on 2 and 4. Sometimes it can play on all 4 beats. Ching, 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 you know, or not at all. You know, even though these things were implied, they all knew because of, you know. So when they did happen, they had more impact. This made the rhythm a lot more fluid and allowed for more possibilities for the band to move around the rhythm. One band in particular that took this concept and feeling further than any other band at the time was, you already knew, some of y'all who knew I was going to say this, or maybe you didn't. But if you didn't, it was Miles Davis's what we now call the Second Great Quintet, or Second Quintet for short. Y'all listen, for those of y'all who haven't heard this stuff before, you all are really true. Like, I want to commend y'all and give y'all a round of applause because some of the music y'all listening to is, like, really out there. And most people, like, we got 80 viewers in the chat. Okay, even if 80 viewers didn't know any of this stuff, that's already 80 more people than what the general population knows about this music. And this, what I'm about to play right now, is something that even some jazz musicians don't even listen to. You got some stubborn jazz musicians that only listen to stuff in the 50s. They don't even know this. So you all are really open-minded people. And for sticking with us, I really, really appreciate it. You have no idea. This makes me very happy. Because that means that whenever we get to play other stuff, you all have a clear open mind. You go listen to it. And even if you don't like it, you don't even have to like it. But you are open to it and you see it. So I appreciate that. But anyway, we call it the second quintet because the first great quintet is considered to be the one featured on the cooking, we're lurking, cooking, we're lurking, cooking, working, relaxing, and steaming sessions with John Coltrane, Red Garland on piano, Paul Chambers on bass, and Philly Joe Jones on the drums for the Prestige. Like, you know, they knocked out those 4 albums in 2 days so that he can get that new contract with Columbia. However, this new quintet would propel the careers of 4 of the most esteemed and highly regarded musicians of genre of all time. Still relevant today, nowhere near considered old, right? Wayne Shorter on tenor and soprano sax, Herbie Hancock on piano, Ron Carter on bass, and a young prodigy drummer from Chicago, 17-year-old, there's hope for y'all, 17-year-old Tony Williams. One of the earliest foundations, actually, for the advent of metal drumming. Mostly because of what people would later call his blast beat. So all y'all who are metal fans, you have Tony Williams to thank for the beats that y'all like to listen to. True fact, you can listen to any of those. You can listen to Megadeth, Metallica, a lot of those cats, they reference Tony Williams as their drum inspiration. It's very, 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 very true. But anyway, this quintet would stretch the public conception of jazz way beyond its boundaries, but somehow keeping enough traditional elements for it to be called jazz, but going so far away from what people knew to also then create a whole new way of playing music. It's crazy. This style of straight swing will be demonstrated in this final example, a track from Miles Davis's 1967 album, Miles Smiles, called Gingerbread Boy. And I remember the first time I heard this one. Woo! Come on now. It's Gingerbread Boy, an original of the great, late great, of course, Jimmy Heath. Rest in peace. You taught us all so much. Thank you so very much. Definitely gone too soon. Really, he lived a great life. Lived an incredible, incredible great life. But yeah, Jimmy Heath. This is Gingerbread Boy from Miles Davis. He said, Tony Williams, now you got me a lot more interested. Okay. You get your, everything is important. Everything is important, you dig? So check this out. This is a little bit of the stylings of the Miles Davis Quintet in 1967. This is not the first gig ever that Herbie Hancock, Ron Carter, and Wayne Shorter ever had. You know, Wayne Shorter was with the Jazz Messengers for a while. Ron Carter played with a bunch of different people. And Herbie Hancock, of course, had his own groups way before that. And Tony Williams, at the age of 13, was playing with Sam Rivers. So, this cat was a prodigy. This cat was like the MK Leo. You know, he was like the MK Leo of music. MK Leo won a tournament at 8 years old for Brawl. But anyway, let's move on. Check this out. So I'm going to listen to this. Pay very close attention to the riot symbol that Tony... So the riot symbol, of course, ding, ticka, ding, ticka, ding, right? Take a listen to how Tony is playing, and he's not sticking to the traditions anymore, right? Just take a listen and take a listen to how they're interacting. And you'll notice that Herbie Hancock is not really playing piano, like, at all, unless he's playing melodies. Bro, they about to get it. Tipping. Watch it. Oh, man. Oh, it's been so long. Sometimes they go completely off of it, and they come back. Okay, I wish I could play the whole thing, but again, like, you know, time's sake. Ooh, it's so good. I love that. It's been so, that, see that, all this that we're playing right now, I used to play this stuff with so many people, man. No matter who it was, we would just go in and play. I could play the New Orleans stuff. I could pull this thing out. Do the little, you know. You know, I can get to the vibe, you know, like. We can go in and play whatever you want. I miss that. You know, we can go whatever it is, we get to it, whatever the vibe, we just go to it. And that's something that, like, I hope that you can understand after all this time what I'm trying to do, you know. But anyway, hopefully this taught you how to listen, at least, out for the different varieties of swing that can exist out there. Even so, remember, this is just like a super small selection, bullet points in a world and a legacy of endless swing feels that are unique to everybody. Even you all have your own swing feel. It's not just them, you know? It's just up to us to understand, like, what this is and what it feels like so we can get a better understanding at communicating it. Just like language, you subconsciously internalize, you know, the nuances, not just the words, but how you say the words, the accent. And that's just exactly what swing is. You can't make a robot do that no matter how hard you try. One of the many reasons why we need to cherish our live musicians and keep them in our lives. We need to. That's so important. And with that being said, that is the end of the Jazz School for today. It was a little bit longer than I thought. I still, believe it or not, I trimmed down like maybe like 70 to 80% of that was there before.